afternoon, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Take Charge of Your Time, How to Be More Efficient in 2018. My name is Michelle Lutman, and I'm the content and media producer here at Surefire Local. I'm also joined by our webinar ninja, Steve Eastlack, who is ready and excited to help answer your questions. Speaking of those questions, you can communicate with us using the question box, which is on the right-hand side of your screen. Why don't you go ahead and see if you can locate that right now and let us know where you're joining us from today. We'll be sending messages and discussion questions to the group throughout the webinar, so be sure to check that out. Before we get into time mastery, I wanted to tell you a little bit about how Surefire Local started and the story behind how the Surefire Local Marketing Cloud is the marketing solution that works as hard as you do. It all started with a small business owner who taught his son the value of hard work. That son, our founder and CEO, Chris, went on to lead several venture-backed Web 2.0 startups, but he never forgot the memories of watching his dad get up early in the morning to track down new business. He wondered if there was a way for 21st century technology to multiply the efforts of small local companies like his father's. Turns out there was. Surefire Local started with an idea, a way to help small businesses rank higher in search engines. Today, it's an unbeatable marketing engine backed up by expert consultants with one mission: help local businesses generate new business by getting discovered online. Over the years, we've had the privilege of working alongside hundreds of local companies and watching many of them double and triple their leads with Surefire Local. Some call it a digital marketing transformation, but we just call it hardworking marketing for hardworking people. Today, one lucky attendee is going to take home a Google Home mini speaker. We'll be announcing the winner at the end. If you don't happen to win one, though, you don't have to go home empty-handed. Everyone here today is eligible to get Mark's new book on time management, but I will get more to that later. Today, we have Mark G. Richardson, leading authority in remodeling industry and author of 3 books. He has a fantastic presentation for you all. So for now, I'm going to pass it on over to Mark. Mark, thanks for joining us today.
Great. Thank you, Michelle, and welcome, everyone. It seems only fitting that being only a couple weeks out between the now and the new year, that folks are focused on, you know, thinking about the new year and thinking about resolutions and how they really want to kind of reposition themselves moving forward. So today we're going to be talking about the subject of time and how you can, in fact, improve and kind of crack the code, quite frankly, on mastering your time. There really are 3 primary kinds of things that I'm going to be talking about today in the webinar. And needless to say, I think mastering time is something that you can understand and appreciate, but it does take some time and practice, certainly, to master it. But the 3 levels of things I'm going to get into today, one is understanding the subject of time. You know, we all certainly have experienced time. We're all dealt with the same amount of time. However, how you understand the time is really critical to how you think about improving. Secondly, we're going to take some inventory. I'm going to share some very practical, pragmatic tools for you to take inventory of your time. You know, I'm a big believer, if you want to get better at something, that you have to start with seeing where you're at this point and certainly improve. And then the last leg of our talk today, I'm going to introduce a time mastery system, a tool that will absolutely help you in terms of the planning process. And if you have access to this tool or the workbook, you'll definitely be able to improve. What I find, and I've literally taught this particular subject to many, many thousands of people, and what I find is people fall into really 3 categories that take this webinar. One is you have a category of folks that are in so much pain with this subject, they really embrace it and develop the habits, and it really is a little bit of a life changer. Truthfully, that's only about 10 or 20% of the folks that listen. Then you have a group of folks out there that is probably the bulk that really have techniques and have things that you presently do, but you're going to be more sensitive to time just by us taking the time on this particular webinar and really discuss it. And then the last group of people are those that, you know, really already are very good at mastering and managing their time, and they're just kind of students of success, and therefore, you know, just being exposed to this is beneficial. So let's start by talking about how time has changed. You know, a friend of mine who won an award says, you know, if you don't change, you'll become irrelevant. So I think this whole notion of change is important in that you got to look at how things have changed. We all know it's changed as it relates to different parts of our lives, but let's just take a quick look at 20 years ago as it relates to time versus today. 20 years ago, technology was really optional, where we're now completely dependent on technology. 20 years ago, there was a pace of time that was really much slower, where today it's much faster. Proliferation and speed is so much faster than it was before. In the past, we used to talk about, even as we moved into the weekends, what are you going to do in your free time? Today, time is not free. We don't even use that same kind of language anymore, because the reality is that we're going at such a fast pace and we have such a full schedule that we're looking at time differently. You know, in the past, we could expect to get back to someone in terms of a time expectation, you know, in possibly 1 to 3 days. And now that expectation is speeded up to the point where it's more like 1 to 3 hours. The whole velocity and speed at which people are expecting things has dramatically changed. In the past, we had kind of office hours, where today, right, wrong, or indifferent, I think most people think in terms of being accessible 24/7. I'm not really advocating these changes that have taken place, but I think we'd all admit that there's a certain reality to it. In the past, we had 24 hours in a day, and today we still have 24 hours in a day. So I encourage you to kind of look at this slide. And if you're not operating really effectively on the right side of this equation, then chances are there's some room for improvement. So in this particular session, I'm going to talk about the 7 steps to time mastery. And these steps are also outlined in my book, Control Your Day Before Your Day Control You. So the first step is you got to understand it. Step 2 is you got to establish strong whys if you're ever going to change. And I think this holds true in a lot of aspects of our lives. You know, if you don't have a strong why behind something, chances are it's not going to move up the priority list, or you're going to be motivated to be able to address it. Number 3 is we're going to take inventory of your time. If you don't understand where you are, it's very hard to appreciate how you're going to improve. And then we're going to start to develop some skills. You know, believe it or not, time has skills just like other skills in our life. Step number 5 is now you're finally going to get to the point where you're going to have a process. You're going to have a system to put in place. And then I'm going to talk about avoiding mistakes. You know, the reality is a lot of your effectiveness in time is avoiding the potholes and the certainly mistakes just as much as doing the right thing. And then lastly, we're going to talk a little bit about taking it to the next level. Now today, I'm going to really stop it at step number 5, but in step number 6 and step number 7, you're going to have access to those if you'd like a copy of my book. You know, I'd love to be able to sell you my book, but my friends here at Surefire are actually giving you that as a gift. So I encourage you to either ask for it directly through them, or you can certainly order it through the normal book sources with Amazon or Barnes & Noble as well. So let's start by talking about a little bit more understanding time. And as I said before, you know, whenever I bring up do you understand time, everybody knows kind of what time is. You know, but the reality is I think you got to look at it through different lenses if, in fact, you're going to be successful. You know, I always, on any topic, I always like to kind of go to a few quotes about a particular subject, whether it's about change or whether it's about the environment or whatever it happens to be. In this case, these are some quotes that are about time. Matter of fact, what's interesting, I was reading recently that there are probably more quotes about time than almost any subject out there. So Ben Franklin said, time is money. Now, when I talk to audiences all the time, and I bring this quote up, you know, immediately they talk about the value of their time. And while, yes, of course, there is value to time, what I think is interesting about this quote is what he was really saying to me is you've got to translate time into something meaningful if you're going to understand it. You know, if you just think about time, what does it taste like, feel like, smell like? You know, it's really a concept of time, not necessarily a thing. And if you can translate time, as I'll talk a little bit more, into something meaningful, it will have greater value to you. You know, I love this quote, too. I've been thinking about this for many, many years. Work expands to fill the time available for its completion. The reality is if you give some task, some activity, an hour to do, it's going to fill generally that amount of time. If you give that same task 40 minutes to do, you're going to figure out a way in doing it to 40 minutes. And then if you think about that, you're going to get a gift. that gift of 20 minutes multiplied over a long period of time is really a big dividend. So what you need to do as you think about time is think about the amount of time that that should take before you actually execute it. You know, time has no meaning in itself unless we choose to give it significance. You know, the fact that you're listening to this webinar, I think, is a good indication that you're choosing. And then lastly, which this integrates into my time mastery system very effectively, is plan your work for today and every day, then work your plan. And let me repeat that. Plan your work for today. It doesn't mean plan your work for next week. Plan your work for today. Do it every day so you get into the habit and the mastery of it. Then you work your plan. Just like a pilot flying an airplane. You're planning it today. You're doing it every day in a consistent way. And then you're following that flight plan. When it comes to time, I think that same methodology really holds true and is quite successful. So translating time, you know, it's important that you start to think about time and having meaning in different ways. Now, you can do this somewhat visually with timelines and certainly clocks, but you can also think about what can I do in that period of time. For example, for some people, 1 hour might represent a 6-mile run or $100. 2 hours might represent watching a movie or $200 or going out on a date with someone. 3 hours might be a drive. If you live here in Washington, D.C., a drive to the beach, or it might be $300. 4 hours, if you're flying from D.C. or more appropriately California to D.C., you can probably do that in about 4 hours. That's what 4 hours represents, a flight all the way across the country. For some people in remodeling, 8 hours might represent building a porch or a small deck, or it might represent a certain amount of money. The point in all this is, the more that you can literally attach time to things that are meaningful to you, you start to have a different degree of value. So I encourage, even with this simple slot, what does 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, 8 hours mean to you? And then you can start to have more value to it. What's interesting is if you can start to save a little bit of time, literally just about 10 minutes a day on some of the different activities you're doing, and then you start to multiply that out, that's about 60 hours a week. You know, what does that mean if I can only save 10 minutes a day over the course of certainly a year? So the point in all this is simple, and that is the more meaningful that you can make time, the more you can translate it, the more value it has to you. So one important theme when it comes to understanding time is the difference between being effective versus being efficient. You know, if you look at the two definitions, in one case, being efficient is about doing something with the least resources in the shortest amount of time, where being effective is more about accomplishing the desired goal and outcome in the best way. You know, I'm a big believer that you need to think about and couple these two together as it comes to becoming more masterful. You know, technologies has really allowed us oftentimes to be more efficient through sending a text or sending an email versus picking up the phone and having a phone conversation. Or again, in this subject of focusing on the kind of why behind things, what we want to do is look at some reasons why you want to try to take some control of your day. You know, again, as I said earlier, I'm a big believer if you can have and establish really strong whys, the likelihood of that you're going to be more successful are greater. For example, coming into the new year, you might say, yeah, I'd like to lose 5-10 pounds into the new year. Well, if you like to lose it just purely for vanity's sake, then you may or may not push away from the table and not have that piece of pie. However, if the doctor's telling you that your cholesterol's too high, and if you don't lose weight, you're going to be medicated, if, in fact, you have risks of health, if you're worried about, for example, the expense of going to the doctor, if you're worried about different elements in terms of, you know, the overall fitness and health, and you have a whole combination of the whys behind it, the likelihood that you're going to be more successful at different kinds of things, including controlling your day, is going to be much greater. So let's go through a few whys. If you have more control of your day, you're going to reduce stress. You're going to reduce the level of overwhelm. And that, by the way, is going to be difficult, but it can happen. You can always accomplish more. You can invest more time into yourself, whether it's personally or professionally improving. You can keep those little promises that you're oftentimes failing to keep. You can exceed the expectations that you have. You know, I think one of the fundamental success habits that the best do is they exceed the expectation. It'll also, if you have more control over your day, it allows you to think more clearly. You know, one of the things that oftentimes is lost as it results to the stress with time is we're not putting enough time and energy in deep thinking. You can also focus on more medium and longer term goals. But the bottom line is, I think with all of this, is that the more control that you have, the better you're going to feel and the more fulfilled you're going to be. So while we can talk about certainly the professional benefits, it also has a lot of personal benefits as well. So let's move into the next part. Let's start to take a little bit of inventory of your present time and your day. You know, what I like to do is ask myself a series of questions, and I'm going to throw out a few questions, and you can just kind of jot down answers to these questions as you think about it moving forward. So the first thing is thinking about the whole subject of what percentage of your day is proactive, which is where you control it, versus reactive that others control. So I encourage everybody to take a moment and think about that, just literally for a few seconds. What percentage of your day and week is proactive that you control or reactive that others control? And write down both of those numbers, because this is really important as you're moving forward and developing these planning systems. Because at the end of the day, if you want to have control of your day, you have got to have more proactive activities, more proactive time. And that is something that you can, in fact, change for yourself. The ideal place for most people, and I say most people because it has a lot to do with the role within the organization of your company, is about 80% proactive and 20% reactive. So there are three primary sources of reactive activity that you can start to chip away at. The first is your clients, the second is your team, and the third is your family. So think about this for a minute, and here's a little tip in this subject. If you're kind of 50-50, 50% proactive and 50% reactive, or 60-40, your goal is to chip away. And if you're 50-50, you want to move it to 55-45 proactive to reactive. So in your clients, if you have a series of clients, you have active clients, you have clients that are under construction, you have clients in the sales process. So write down Monday morning these 8 or 10 clients that you have in these different stages and proactively communicate to them, because they're the ones that create reactive activities. You simply want to reach out via email or text or voicemail or whatever it happens to be, and just let them know that you're thinking about them. And if, in fact, they would like to talk to you, set an appointment, set a time that you're going to actually have the conversation with them. Similarly, with your team, we're constantly interrupted by the team. Now, we as kind of nice human beings, we oftentimes think that not answering the interruptions that a team member or coworker may have is kind of being rude. Not necessarily. It's what it's actually doing is it's keeping you from being productive and proactive. And as a result of that, you're going to fall short, and you might even be a little less patient and a little less effective with their question. So whenever anybody comes up to you, ask them, would it be okay if, in fact, I addressed your question or we sat down and focused on your problem at a specific time? 3 out of 10 people are going to say absolutely. 3 out of 4 out of 10 people are going to maybe say it needs to be addressed right away, and the other 3 people out of 10 are probably going to go solve it on their own. So you can see dramatic shifts if, in fact, you take a little bit more of a proactive, not rude and disrespectful, but a little bit more proactive approach to those interruptions. The same kind of thing holds true with your family as well. So moving forward to take some inventory, let's ask a few questions. What would that ideal day look like for you? You know, literally get out a piece of paper and map that day out for you. What would that ideal day that would feel more meaningful and feel more fulfilled? You know, do the same thing on a week scale. What would that ideal week look like for you? And then also you might look at a month scale. So if one way you're going to improve in terms of time inventory is start with kind of the end in mind and really focus on what the ideal day and week might look like for you. The next thing you want to do is start to look at the blends of your time. How are you spending your time? You know, what percentage of the time do you spend on short-term activities? What percentage of your time do you spend on medium, 1 to 4 weeks? And then how much time are you spending on the long term? See, what's happened with the speed of which pace in life is, we're spending almost all of our time on the short term, a little bit on the medium term, and very, very little on the long term kind of the issues that are out there. And the reason I focus on this is you've got to be spending some amount of time on the longer term activities, or the longer term, in this case, activities that you want to be thinking about. So the next thing is, when it comes to your time blend, I encourage you to kind of break it in part. You know, what I find in working with different leaders and individuals is when you really break apart your time, that's where a lot of the answers come. So I'm going to give you a little quick chart here that is a nice way to be able to do this. So what you want to do is create a simple chart. You don't need any spreadsheet or anything. You don't need any special technologies. Just literally create a little grid. And in that grid, on the left-hand column, list the main categories, 5 to 7 categories of activities you spend time on. In this case, selling, marketing, training, project work, staff meeting selections, and more of the administrative or miscellaneous time. Put the amount of time per week that you put into that. So in this case, it's about a 45-hour week, and you can see I plugged in different amounts of hours to that. Translate that in terms of the percentage of the total week, and that gives you kind of a little bit of an abstraction, but at least helps you kind of think of it like a pie chart. Then actually spend some time thinking about what would be the ideal number of hours for you. In this case, if you could just get out selling a little bit more, that's going to maybe close more deals and make you be more effective. If I could just do a tiny little bit, another hour a week of marketing, I could generate and not have so much herky-jerky in terms of lead flow. Training, I could spend a little bit more time. Now, as you go down to the bottom, where am I going to carve some of that time? Because I'm not advocating necessarily that you spend more time. I'm advocating that you kind of reproportion the amount of time that you're spending. Just by doing this simple exercise, it not only shows you where you are and what is ideal, but then it also gives you the ability to start to plan differently, come up with strategies and tactics that allow this to happen if you're ever going to shift and see the improvement. So another element when it comes to taking inventory is looking at your time skills. What's interesting, I think most human beings and certainly professional people, I would estimate maybe 80% tend to be more visual thinkers. So the more you start to develop visual cues and visual tools for yourself, it helps you to physically see the day and create order in the day, i.e. a timeline or a clock or certainly a calendar, or even in construction, a more common Gantt chart, kind of helps you to visualize the amount of time. Estimating. You know, if you're ever going to understand and be better at time, you've got to be better at estimating time. Estimating time is a skill just like everything else. So a few tips on estimating time. The first is don't be afraid. Whenever I ask people, I can always tell when I say, how long does something take? Oftentimes there's a certain fear of being wrong. You're never going to get good at estimating time unless you're not fearful. And related to that is if you always think in terms of ranges of time, you're going to be more successful and always be better at it. Another thing is always think about time or try to think about time in terms of breaking it into its parts, not just the whole. So as I think about, for example, doing a major project, whether it's writing a column or doing, you know, I'll break it in terms of the amount of time of maybe creating the outline, creating the draft, and then maybe the editing process. By breaking it into parts, I'm going to be more likely to be realistic and accurate with the amount of time that it's going to take. Kind of, again, you can't eat an elephant in one bite, and I think if you break it into parts, you're going to be more successful. Another thing when it comes to estimating time, you know, try not to be too optimistic. Try to be aggressive. In other words, you want an edge, but be very realistic about the time it takes to do certain things. I have many, just like you, many little tasks, responding to emails, leaving a voicemail, sending a text, those kind of things, many little tasks, all of which maybe only take 30 or 60 seconds, but allow a little bit of time because some are going to take a little bit longer to do. And then, of course, you need to practice. If you want to be better at estimating time, you've got to practice. So by doing it every single day, you're going to get better at it. It's going to be an integral part of your thinking, and it's going to be really second nature to you. So I'm going to take a quick break before I actually get into the system and the time mastery system and turn it back over to Michelle for a little notion here.
Thank you, Mark. While Mark takes a quick water break, we want to ask if you would like a copy of Mark's book, Control Your Day Before It Controls You. So please select yes if you would like one. We ask that if you request this book, you do it in exchange for a brief conversation about your digital marketing with Surefire. Also, Mark has a great time mastery workbook where you can put out or plan out your day minute by minute. If you would like this too, you can email marketing@surefirelocal.com with your shipping address, and we can ship that to you as well.
Excellent. Thank you, Michelle. And again, as I said earlier, I really appreciate certainly my friends here at Surefire not only bringing you this particular type of webinar, but also providing you certainly a gift of the book here. And again, there's no obligations for anything. It's just, I think, a gesture on their part in exchange for a brief conversation. So I encourage you, because this book goes into a lot more detail into what I'm talking about today, and you have it documented in such a way that you can kind of practice certainly what we're talking about a little differently. So moving into the third kind of leg of the seminar today, I want to be talking about the time mastery system. So at the beginning, we've talked about, you know, the importance of understanding time. Then we move towards taking inventory of your time. But now you need a tool. You know, just like a carpenter, you know, for example, the pain point by understanding the project. You have a plan, but now you need some tools to be able to be successful at it. So this time mastery system was something that I developed about 30 years ago. And I've practiced it, I've taught it to hundreds and even thousands of people at this point, and it's really based on the methodology and the philosophies that you're seeing and reading throughout the course of the early part of this webinar. So there really are a series of steps to this process, and I'm going to walk you through the steps, and we're actually going to do a little example of how this works. And again, this is laid out, I think, fairly effectively in the book and the workbook as well. So walking you through the process and the steps. And I think time mastery is a process, just like baking cookies is a process, just like going on an effective trip is a process. So the first step is you need to have the right kind of preparation. Then you need a brain dump. Then step number three is you're going to take a time out and reflect on it. And I'm going to go through an example of this. So for those of you that think I'm moving too fast, don't worry. Then you need to attach time. You need to literally take your brain dump. And this is where I think most of you fall short today, is you don't really look at the amount of time that the specific items in the brain dump are going to take. Then you actually set up a timeline. That's kind of your roadmap, so to speak. Then from your roadmap, then you do some analysis. Because the reality is, if you've got a roadmap that shows that you've got 12 hours of activities, you can't jam them in an 8-hour time slot. So you've got to do some analysis of that brain dump. Then you want to start to color in and block out the given activities, the meetings, the different kind of things that you're doing, just like this webinar. Then you want to incorporate activities. Now you're going to be tying the two things together, the brain dump activities and the timeline itself. Then you're going to launch the process. And then lastly and most importantly is you're going to monitor it. One of the biggest mistakes people make when it comes to a system like this is they tend not to monitor it. They kind of memorialize the process and leave it on the shelf, so to speak. But this is something that you need to kind of actively walk around and have your plan, like a roll of blueprints under your arm as you're walking around, as opposed to, you know, just at the end of the day saying, how am I doing? You know, think about that coach on the sideline of a football game. You know, he has in his hand the game plan. He's monitoring it regularly based on how the team is doing and the different plays that are being called. So the following is a framework for the first 30 days. You know, I'm a big believer, if you want to embrace some of these techniques, you need to commit 30 days to be able to do it. You know, 30 days of a commitment is how you form a habit. You know, it's been proven it takes 21 days to form most habits. So what you need to commit to, if you want to be successful at this, other than being interested or intrigued with some of the techniques, is go ahead and commit 30 days to really do this. Now, what's amazing, if you do that, and you think you're slipping in terms of time, I'm going to give you a dividend of time back that's pretty substantial. The second is just recognize, just like with anything, if you're going on a diet or changing, you know, habits of any type, the first week is always a little bit tough. Follow the techniques I'm giving you today 100%. You must invest a minimum of 30 minutes a day if you're going to be successful at this. Now, oftentimes say people, that sounds great, I don't have 30 minutes. But after about a week and a half, you're going to get not only the 30 minutes back, but I'll be giving you an hour back of day. So you're going to start after about a week and a half to see the dividends. Another element in my system that I'm a big believer is you've got to incorporate professional and personal activities together. Some people like to put things in bucket, but I think going back to the change of time today, the fact that we are operating very, very 24/7 in terms of our thinking, you've got to include your kind of holistically your whole day if you're going to be successful. Try to be disciplined but not obsessed when it comes to the kind of things that we're talking about. Just try to have the habits that you do this every single day. So let's move on to when you're going to do this. You've got to do the planning in the morning, not the night before. Now, for those of you that do a little to-do list the night before, you can still do that on a separate piece of paper, but it's not what you want to do. It is not your plan. Something mysteriously happens overnight, and that plan becomes kind of like Swiss cheese the next day. So you've got to do it in the morning. And I know for some of you that's going to be a little bit tough because of your personal and your professional routines in the morning, but I would strongly encourage adjusting that routine to allow this process to happen. So the first thing you want to do in the morning is find a quiet place. You know, the breakfast table with the kids is not a quiet place to do this planning technique. You know, for those of you that are bouncing around, you can always find a quiet place to use these techniques. They could be in the corner of a restaurant. They could be in a conference room on the other side of the showroom. They might even be, quite frankly, in your car to be able to do these. But you need a quiet place to be able to think. The second is that start at least 60 minutes before the first scheduled activity. So if you have, let's say, a meeting with a client at 8 o'clock, you have to be sitting down probably at 7 o'clock doing this particular session. Try to be consistent place if you can. Adjust the environment in that particular day, but try to be consistent as you can. I think you'll be more effective. So make sure if you're doing this to have everything, all your kind of givens, all your information in front of you. Your data, your notes, your tools, your computer, whatever those parts and pieces are, your phone, your emails, all those things, have those in front of you so you'll have access to that. Turn your cell phone off. You know, it's important, I think, that you really focus and concentrate. And at least for this first 30 or 40 minutes in the day, you don't need to be constantly having interruptions because it will affect, I think, the effectiveness of the plan itself. So I'm going to walk you through an actual example of how to do this. Now, imagine that you have an 8.5 by 11 notebook. It's critical to have a notebook to be able to do this. I'm a big believer that it's a spiral notebook. So the first thing you want to do is write at the top of the page. In the notebook, if you like access to the notebook that my friends at Surefire will give you, you can actually have templates within the notebook. But the first thing you want to do is you want to put the date at the top and some sort of theme for the day. I'm a big believer in what's your theme for that particular day. You know, it might be focused in this day, it was focused on balance. You know, balance of the different kind of balls that were being jugged, balance between personal and professional, balance between, you know, sales and marketing, whatever those things, balance was a theme in this particular day. So the first thing you want to do is probably something very familiar to you is what I call the brain dump. The brain dump is very much like your to-do list. You're going to literally bump, dump, dump, dump until you can't think of anything else that day. Now, when you're doing the brain dump, you'll think of other things that you need to do on following days. So just jot those on another piece of paper or put those on your calendar on the following day. But you can see from this list, it's a fairly typical to-do list. Includes, you know, just functional things like having lunch, meetings. It includes picking up a card for an individual. You know, it even includes acknowledging someone's birthday. Everything on that particular day that you want to do. Then you have what I call reactive time. And again, this is highlighted in the workbook. That's when you want to have an amount of reactive time that everybody is going to have. Just like I said before, 80% proactive, 20% react. Now, at the beginning of this process, we're going to encourage you to start with about 120 minutes a day, and I'll talk about that in a minute, of reactive time. But what you want to do with a brain dump, after you've got this to-do list brain dump down, then get up and go get a cup of coffee or a glass of water or fresh air. Just literally spend 1, 2, 3 minutes in what I call kind of more of a timeout. And when you do that, think about and ask yourself, is there anything else I'd like to try to accomplish today? Professional, personal, any kind of longer-term goals I'd like to inch forward. And when you do that, you're going to come up with a couple of additional things that you can get on your brain dump list. In this case, it was a new training concept and also setting a lunch with my godfather that I hadn't seen for a long period of time. So now I have the raw material of my brain dump with the additional reflected items in front of me. The next thing I want to do is attach time to each one of those. So it's very simple. Just guess at the amount of minutes each one of those is going to take. And as you can see from this exercise, some of them take only a few minutes and some take longer. Again, as I said before, on the reactive time, allow 120 minutes for reactive time. Then what you want to do is add up all the time that you just put in there, divide by 60, and that gives you the amount of hours that all these things are going to take, including the 120 minutes of reactive time. Do not forget the reactive time. It's a reality, it's life, it's going to exist, so why not account for it? The next thing you want to do is now start to develop a roadmap or a timeline. So you literally, every day is a different timeline. So you draw a line and you have different time components within that. So you want to start to set up when those blocks of time are. And I know with my schedule and most people I coach, it's varied every single day. If I've got a meeting that's going to last 60 minutes one day and another meeting on another day that's going to last 90, it's going to look differently. So every day is a different profile of a timeline. The next thing you want to do is create letters for each of the blocks of time. A, B, C, D. Those are not priorities. Those are blocks of time. Then you want to block out the meetings and the event. I like to see my timeline. So in this case, it's a little hard to see. Between 8:30 and 10, I blocked out because I must have had a meeting at that time. And between 2 and 3, I had another meeting. Now, here's where I think the magic comes. And this is where, as simple as it is, what you want to do is hook the two together. You want to hook the brain dump together to the timeline. As you can see, it's not that hard to do, and if you're not 100% sure when you want to do the different activities, then just go ahead and plug it in, because when you do the analysis, you can always adjust and change it. Obviously, lunch happens in the middle of the day, and obviously calling someone, Tom Kay in Oregon, probably happens at the end of the day because of the time difference from East Coast to West Coast. So now, as you see, I've got all the letters. The next thing I want to do is do a little bit of analysis. As you can see, between 7 and 8:30 is 90 minutes, and all the A's on the left side add up to 80. So what it tells me is that fits. It fits. It's okay. Check. Move on. Next thing I want to do is move towards a launch. So now I have the plan in front of me. I have the roadmap. Now I want to launch my day. All I need to do at this juncture is think about the A's, because if it's 7 o'clock, I know between 7 and 8:30 I need to focus on the A's. So I just literally look at some of those A's. For example, the first one was setting some appointments. So they require just setting out a series of emails, describing an agenda for some of those appointments, and then, as you can see, by focusing just on the A's, then you get it accomplished. Now, the next thing you want to do is monitoring. One of the most common mistakes with this system is not monitoring it. You've got to monitor this every 60 to 90 minutes. In other words, how am I doing? Am I on track? So the best way to monitor it is you're accomplishing each one, circle that particular item, and I think it shows you when it's complete. And again, as you're moving out throughout your day, only focus on the items in that time slot. If you have a little bit of extra time and you want to grab another one to get done, that's fine. But keep in mind, the amount of time between 7 o'clock and 6:30 is 11 hours, and you've determined that this takes 11.25 hours. So that matches up, and if you add additional things that you do that day that are not part of that plan, you might fall short. So what I want to do real quickly with you is just go through a very, very quick kind of almost like a mini speed dating of this particular session here to be able to give it to you. So again, I'm not expecting you to write down anything, but just think about how quickly I do this. First thing is the date and the theme, and it becomes a record. The next thing is a brain dump, including all the way down to reactive time. Take a time out, add additional items to it. Add the amount of time, total the amount of time. Now I want to set the timeline up. You can see I'm doing that. Next thing you want to do is have blocks of time that go in. The next thing you do, I want to literally color in when I have the meeting so I can see the gaps better. The next thing I want to do is hook the two things together. The next thing is do an analysis of the brain dump, and when you add up all the analysis, you make sure it works. So now I've got a plan that's solid in place that I know can work, and then I can launch it and move on, and then, of course, monitoring it throughout the day. So that's really the system. Again, this is something you can do manually on a notebook. It's really important to do this manually up front for the first 30 days. And then in the future, if you want to try to add a little bit of technology, you can certainly do that. But this is very, very effective, high-touch kind of method to be able to control your day before your day controls you. So let me run through a few common mistakes that I see out there and a few questions that people might have. And then I want to turn it over to Michelle and Steve to be able to highlight some of your questions that are coming in on the webinar. So the first mistake I oftentimes see is forcing 14 hours in a 10-hour day. Doesn't work. Don't launch your day until you get the times to roughly line up. All you're doing is setting yourself up for a failure, and if you fail, you're going to feel crappy at the end of the day and not fulfilled. So don't do that to yourself. That's your fault. Activities are too general. So you want to break activities down enough so that not only you can break the time into it. For example, put together the Jones proposal, you might want to break that in a series of parts. You know, writing an outline, 10 minutes, developing an estimate, 60 minutes, developing an actual proposal itself, 60 minutes, and then calling the client to confirm the assumptions, 10 minutes. All those things take different amounts of time. So don't be too general and just say Jones proposal. Next thing you want to do is, or another common mistake is spending only 15 minutes. Matter of fact, what's ironic is when you're overwhelmed, you actually need to spend more time, not less time, or if you want to be more fulfilled and accomplish more. On average, I spend personally 40 to 45 minutes a day, and when I'm overwhelmed, I've got 80 balls in the air, I'll spend 60 minutes on that plan before I work the plan. So don't cut yourself short. A 15-minute plan just doesn't work. It's almost like a to-do list, and it's not very effective. Not being in a quiet place to do the plan. Getting too creative in the process. You know, the reality is a lot of people that take these webinars are very creative people, and don't be creative in the first 30 days. Just follow this system. I can guarantee it's going to be effective for most people, and if you can just, you know, follow the system. Another mistake is not monitoring. You know, this is going to be a little awkward for some, but the reason I think a spiral notebook is really important is then you can carry it with you as you're walking to and from the office or out in your car, stopping at a stoplight, you can sit down and take a look at how am I doing, and then you can always adjust the plan as you're moving along. Now, I like to draw a parallel to this to like a flight plan. You know, when there's weather conditions, air traffic, all sorts of different things that are going on, turbulence, you know, the pilot adjusts as he goes, but the only way he'll do that is by monitoring it as he's moving along. Another mistake is just giving up. As I said, commit to 30 days because you won't really get into the rhythm of doing this effectively until about 2 weeks into it. So a few frequently asked questions. Should I do this over the weekend? Well, it's really up to you, but quite frankly, I don't think it's a bad idea to surrender on the weekends and not do this particular thing. You know, on the weekend, you might do a rough little to-do list, but there's nothing wrong with kind of turning it over to your family and spouse and saying, okay, I'll let kind of the situation control things, not necessarily rigidly control it myself. Can I use another type of notebook? Unfortunately, no. You need an 8.5 by 11 spiral notebook to be successful. And again, you can use the template if you request it from Surefire, but you can also just use a basic 8.5 by 11 spiral notebook. When should I return emails and calls? This is a pretty common question. For some people, it's not a bad idea to set maybe 2 or 3 times during the day to be able to do that. But again, you should control it and not necessarily just react to emails and calls. Can I do the planning the night before? Unfortunately not. For those that are used to do that, they can't sleep because they have so many things whirling around, go ahead and make a little to-do list. And then with that to-do list, have it next to your notebook that next morning so that you can incorporate those things in. If that makes you feel better, then I would encourage you to do it. What if my brain dump doesn't add up to the time allowed for the day? You know, that's fairly common. You know, that sometimes it's have too much, but sometimes it's not enough. You know, that's a luxury, unfortunately, I rarely ever have. However, if you do have that, you know, go into your medium and longer term kind of things that you want to try to accomplish and weave those into it until the total amount of time adds up to the total window of the day available to you. Can I make changes to the plan during the day? Yeah, you need to. Now more than ever, you're going to have appointments, you're going to have curveballs, you're going to have things cancel. You know, I've gotten into the mode because of that to confirm appointments first thing in the morning just to make sure that my plan is not corrupted and it's confirmed with the people that I'm actually having meetings, calls, and appointments with. What happens if my day crashes and burns? Well, that happens. You know, if you get a call from the school that your daughter's sick and you got to go pick her up after you create a good plan, then chances are it's going to crash and burn. What I encourage when it happens, number one, just surrender it, let it go. The difference in the success of using this system is that in a typical 5-day week for most people, 3 of those days you should be able to nail it 100%. One of those days you should be able to hit it about 80%. And then you should just assume that one day a week, it's just going to fail on you. But the reality is, today, you have 5 days of the week that are you bumbling along. So that's a big, big improvement and a big dividend. But if you have a crash and burn kind of day, restructure the day. You know, actually, you can do a new plan starting at 12 o'clock and then finishing at 5 or 6 o'clock. And just it's a modified plan that I think helps you get through it. So just some concluding kind of comments. You know, your success is a verb. You know, success is a verb. It's not a noun. You know, your success with this system is in the actions that you take from doing this. So I encourage you, as you're really trying to improve, especially moving into the new year, into this area, don't keep it a secret. Tell your friends and your family that you're really trying to improve. You're trying to, you know, get more control of your day. You know, because you'll find the support from your friends and your colleagues, and certainly from myself as well, to be your time coach in all of this, I think you're going to be more successful. So my last little adage here that I'll turn it then back over to Michelle is the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So as you move into the new year, you know, don't go into this with good intentions. Go into this with actions. Go into this and you're going to find, I think, dividends that are going to be worth a tremendous amount at the end of the day. So I want to thank you for joining us today, and I want to turn it over to Michelle, and I think we have a couple of questions that I'll be able to answer before the end of the call. Michelle?
Yep. Thank you, Mark. Before we get into questions and the Google Home mini giveaway, we want to mention again, just in case you stepped away from your computer earlier, about getting a copy of Mark's book. Again, we ask that you request this book in exchange for a brief conversation about your digital marketing with Surefire. So take a second here to answer, and while you're answering, actually we'll get into those questions. So we had one from Dan, and he asked, with so many time-saving methods available, if you could pick only one thing an individual could do that would have the most positive impact on their time management, what would it be?
Well, needless to say, having had 25, 30 years of developing this time mastery system, it's such a simple system. I think for those that embrace it, they're really going to see the returns from doing it. So first and foremost, I would say, you know, grab this time mastery system I've just shared with you. It doesn't require any special technologies or program. It's a very manual process, and start with that. But the biggest thing is, if you're going to improve anything that you do, it requires time. Give yourself the license and the time to get better. And just by literally blocking out 30 minutes, 45 minutes a day to focus on how you improve on this, you're going to see dividends that are really huge.
Great. Another question we have is, what advice do you have for new employees who are still figuring out what tasks are expected of them and how long they take?
You know, that's also a great question, because the environment that you're in, I think, does affect your knowledge of how long certain things will take. So I encourage, if you're in a new environment, let's say a new employee, you may not want to adopt a system quite like this until you kind of get your land legs, until you get comfortable. Once you do have that, after about a month, then I think you can overlay a system like this, a recipe, and a process to be successful.
All right, and then we have one last one here. I have been at my firm for over 20 years and end up being the one that all the employees come to for help. I am the type of person that enjoys helping others, which is why I am in the field that I am. The problem is I spend the bulk of my day helping others or being interrupted that I don't get my own work completed and end up staying after the hours that we close until late into the evening to get my projects done. I don't know how to help the others get my work done and try to do it in a normal work week. I typically work over 60 hours a week. Your insight would be much appreciated.
You know, I talked about this a little bit earlier, of kind of the doing some analysis on proactive time versus reactive. So clearly in your case, you have a lot of proactive time. And I think everyone listening to this, you have a lot of reactive time. Everyone listening to this, I think your question really hits a chord. You know, the misconception a lot of people have is, I am not being kind if I don't address those interruptions. I would argue that many people are a little bit frustrated. You have a little bit of edge. You can be a little snarky with people interrupting you. There's nothing wrong to say to someone, you know, Mary or John, can I get with you in about an hour, let's say 1 o'clock, and address this particular question or problem? Just ask that question. And again, as I said earlier, 3 or 4 out of 10 are going to say just fine, and now you're going to be able to focus on it with a clear head and with just as much kindness. 3 or 4 out of 10 are going to say, nope, I got to deal with it right now. It's a fire. It needs to be pushed out, or it needs to be dealt with, and you got to deal with it. And then there's another 3 that probably didn't need to come to you anyway, and they end up solving it themselves. So you've literally seen about a 60 or 70% improvement by utilizing that simple method. But a lot of it, honestly, is your head trash, because the reality is you think you're being unkind by setting a time to address their problem as opposed to dropping what you're doing.
All right. Well, thank you for all those questions, and thanks for those great answers, Mark. So we're going to move on to the lucky recipient of the Google Home Mini, and the lucky winner is Jonathan Bray. Congrats, Jonathan. Please email marketing@surefirelocal.com with your full shipping address, and we will get that right to you. Huge thanks to Mark for joining us today, and thank you to all of our attendees. Please be sure to join us for more webinars in the near future. For details on that, you can check out our newly updated surefirelocal.com. We have a link at the top of our homepage for the webinar that's occurring the next week. And I want to mention again, along with the book, if you want the Time Mastery Workbook, you can just email marketing@surefirelocal.com and we will ship that to you as well. So please take a minute to fill out the survey at the end and let us know how we did today and what topics you would like to hear about in the future. Thanks again and have a great afternoon.